Heart and circulation. It is incredible. Peri, look at that word. I like it. Peri means around. Cardium means heart. So we have these sacs that go around the heart, pericardium. We also have sacs around the lungs, so the ribs don't gouge us when we move. There's a septum, which is something I want to show here. There's septum divide the heart into chambers. So we have a interventricular, which is in between the ventricles. We get a nice view of the ventricles here, by the way. And atrial. Yeah, I like that. The blue, if you're wondering what the blue is deoxygenated blood that's being pumped to the lungs. All right, we'll get into details here. AV means atrioventricular. I should have added that. And it's a good word because here's the atria, here's the ventricle. So there's valves between the two so that blood doesn't go backwards. Yeah. Now, these valves have different names because they are AV valves, but they're also tricuspid. Patient's right side, okay, to you it looks like the left, but think of your patient laying on the gurney, tricuspid. On the left side, bicuspid or mitral. And so, in a way, this one has three names. It's an AV valve, that's a bicuspid or mitral. In medicine, you often see the word mitral. Okay, chordae tendineae are the tendons that help pull the valve open. And when these valves shut, the AVs, we get this sound called lup. They're interventricular septum we got to see just a minute ago. Semilunars. And so let's take a look at the semilunars. I think we're gonna have to move ahead a bit. Yeah. Semilunars are going to prevent backflow. Again, the blue is deoxygenated, going to the lungs. Red is oxygenated, going to the body. The semilunars, ooh, look at that. Oh, they're labeling the chordae for us. The semilunar, watch it. Oh, come on. Open, close, open, close. Okay, that's where you get the dub sound, if you're listening with a stethoscope, that is. All right, so let's look at some details here. Aortic. Pulmonary, all right, semilunar valves to prevent backflow of these large blood vessels. Systole refers to contraction of ventricles. Okay, so the ventricles, when they contract, and it's really real logical, okay? When they contract, then the semilunars are going to open up. Makes sense, yeah? I mean, that blood's got to go somewhere. So, diastole is when the atria contract and the ventricles get to relax. All right, now we don't learn the heart in 10 minutes, so plan on reviewing this a few times, okay? But once you get it, you're going to love it because the heart makes sense. All right, here I'm going to talk a little bit about the what's called the cardiac cycle. And that involves really what I've been talking about, the changing in the pressure in the heart. And so let's take a look here. There's a little bit on the, it shows some EKG action, which I really like. So I'm going to be talking about EKG. It ties in with the contraction of the heart because when there's pressure in the ventricles, then these semilunars are going to open up. When there's pressure in the atria, then the AV valves are going to open up. Come on, I thought you were going to show that. Maybe right about here. Yeah, there we go. Atria. They're compressing, opening the AV valve, and the blood is flowing into the ventricles. Beautiful. And then when the ventricles contract, then we're going to have blood leaving the heart. There we go. We should see it. Come on, push on through. Well, we know where it's going to go. Okay. So that is the cycle. Output is like if you have a patient, what's their cardiac output? That gives you an idea of how much blood is being expelled from the heart, from the ventricles. This is a beautiful drawing because we get to see atrium, ventricle to the lungs to get oxygen, atrium, ventricle to the body through the aorta. Okay, until the day we die. AV lungs, AV body. Yeah, it's not so hard. I mean, there's some words to learn. Vena cava, superior, it's coming from the head. Deoxygenated, that's why it's blue. Now, your blood's not really blue, of course, but we do this so that you can see, okay, deoxygenated lungs, oxygenated. And you know what? Oxygenated blood is really bright red. So when you come across a patient, if the blood is reddish and bubbly, then you're worried that an artery. Myocardium is the pumping muscle of the heart. There's three layers of heart muscle, but the myocardium is the thick, and it has these connections called intercalated discs. And if you see these lines, then you know, okay, that's cardiac tissue, and it's going to pump in perfect unison. So the heart is like, it quivers. The contractions are so powerful. I have mentioned a little bit about the electrical system. There's an SA node, sinoarterial, and an AV, atrioventricular. I like these words because here's the atrium, here's the ventricle, so atrioventricular node. Why do we have two? Well, the master cardiac pacemaker is the SA, but its impulse is so powerful that the AV has to sort of control it, suppress it a little bit, and then send it through the bundle of His, and it flows over the ventricles. And this contraction is measurable through an EKG. So we sometimes use alcohol and we have to shave the patient. 12 lead is a common system. And what we're going to do, oh, and make sure the room is warm too, because if they shiver, then your readings will get messed up. Here's all what I've talked about: SA, AV, bundle of His, Purkinje. And then we get these readings, which I want to talk about here. Now, this is an ideal wave of P, which is a, it shows you, hey, the SA is working. And then the QRS shows us that the impulse is going over across the ventricles. And the T wave just shows where the ventricles get to rest. Now, there's variations in this. Like if we see an inverted T, we think, oh my gosh, maybe part of the myocardium is dead because there's a coronary artery, or there's a problem with the conducting system of the SA. So we have to do further testing. Yeah. Arteries, these are important because they're under enormous pressure. The heart is pumping and it goes subclavian, which means under the clavicle. Axillary armpit, brachial arm. Aorta, descending aorta, abdominal aorta. Renal to the kidneys. Iliac to the legs, femur or femoral. And this is why when someone has a bone breakage, we consider a hazardous condition for them, because if the sharp edge of that bone, like a femur especially, if the sharp edge of the bone tear an artery, then you got to apply direct pressure and call for help, because there's so much blood pressure going on that the blood loss is enormous, and you do not move that leg. I mean, I've used sticks and newspapers, spaghetti bags, and wrapped them to try to immobilize patients before. So anytime there's a bone breakage, it's a potential, it could cause death. Okay. Lumen just means the inside, and I mentioned the high blood pressure. We measure the BP close to the heart, and that's why I don't like measuring at the wrist. But sometimes, if you have an obese patient, your BP cuff may not fit over the arm, and so you have to cuff them down low. And then there's other devices that actually want to take pressure at the wrist because it's easy. Yeah, I mean, you can get readings. Baroreceptors, those are for short-term control over blood pressure. So our body has some regulation, endothelium inner lining. So you can see that arterioles are thinner. And I'm going to show you what I'm talking about here. We go from an artery to an arteriole to a capillary. And then we get this capillary bed. We're going to exchange nutrients and oxygen. And then we're going to go venules, vein, heart. So if you're wondering what I'm talking about, okay, large arteries, arterioles, like if you blush, the arterioles, they tend to expand or contract. Venules, if you have hemorrhoids or you see these in different areas of the body. I mentioned contract or expand. Vasodilation, that's when the lumen expands. Histamines, heat, infection. So this is why we don't take cold medicines, because if we have an infection in our nasal cavity, we get stuffed up because vasodilation. Okay, we have increased blood flow and we're going to destroy that invader. And so try not to use Tylenol or some of these cold medicines, because then they get you back to here. You're feeling great, but then the infection worsens. We need to be stuffed up. That's just the way it is, man. All right. Yeah, I mentioned healing to tissues, leukocytes. Okay, capillaries. I talked a little bit about capillaries, how they are in capillary beds, and we're going to exchange nutrients and oxygen. There's also these sphincters that are going to regulate flow. And capillaries are only one cell thick, so they become leaky real easy in case of infection or irritation. And that's a good thing, right? I mean, we have edema sometimes, but I'll mention that. Venules, I talked about that, and veins. Now these are they're under pressure, but not like the arteries, okay? So an artery is under pressure from the heart pumping. And there are situations where if there's a blockage or problems, the artery will produce its own anastomosis, a bypass basically. And we see this in the coronary arteries on the top of the heart. There's a blockage, and if the heart is on the ball, it will bypass that all on its own. Pretty cool. We're built to survive. All right, now I mentioned heart contractions drive the arterial system, oxygenated blood, but what about blood when it's at the end of its like at the tips of your toes? It's hit the capillary beds, it's deoxygenated. We got to get it back to the lungs. So how do we get it back to the lungs? We don't have little pumps in our toes or fingers. Well, the smooth muscles that line these channels can help contract and move blood to the heart. And that's okay. It shows it here. You see, veins have valves. Arteries, we don't want valves because we're pumping huge volumes of blood through there. Veins are also thin-walled. Like when I'm working on a cadaver, I'm in the neck and the carotid and the jugular are right next to each other. I always know the jugular vein, it's very thin-walled. Carotid's thick because remember, arteries are under enormous pressure, so the blood vessels are thick. Skeletal muscles. Okay, this is really a huge way that blood gets back to the heart. And that's why we got to move, okay? I mentioned it here somewhere, body movement. Okay, when you have patients, you sometimes have to turn them or even put them on a machine that moves their body, because if we're not contracting these muscles, then we're going to have pooling of blood. And we sometimes see that in patients that have swollen ankles. Maybe they have congestive heart failure. But my point is, it's not the veins that are dysfunctional in many cases. I mean, we do have varicose. Varicose is a situation. But oftentimes, the veins are doing their job, but we're not doing our job. We are not moving enough. And so we have to move until we die.